Exploring the bizarre. Your e-ticket ride into the world of the paranormal. Strap yourself in as we traverse the universe, exploring the unexplained. UFOs. Ghosts. Lost worlds. Cryptozoology. As well as other dimensions. It's time to take back the night. Now, your electrifying hosts of Exploring the Bizarre, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Boy, I'm just leaning back here tonight. I love a good crashed flying saucer story. And we've got a couple of them tonight. Man, we're really going to hog tie it and take this thing to the limits. And Tim Swartz, are you there in Indiana?
Yes, I am, Tim. I'm here and I'm ready to go tonight.
Oh boy, I'm here on just off of Fifth Avenue, and it's getting chilly, but I think our conversation will just heat up as the evening goes on. And we've got two experts on. We've always got experts on. Tim, I think we've come a long way since we started broadcasting, and we continue just to bring forth some of the greatest information to the public imaginable. I mean, we've just had some fabulous guests on in the past, and we're not going to be outdone tonight. In fact, we've got a great show coming up. Yeah, you want to tell the audience there who we will be discussing the topic of crash flying saucers with?
Well, certainly, Tim. Well, tonight we have our very special guest, Frank Thayer, who is a co-author of the Aztec Incident Recovery at Hart Canyon, and he is Frank is now a professor emeritus at New Mexico State University, and he has professional experience as a writer, editor, photographer, and educator both in New Mexico and Canada, and we'll be discussing the alleged Aztec UFO crash. And what was supposed to be in March of 1948, and it was actually the subject one of the I think first books ever written about a crash flying saucer. It was the 1950s Behind the Flying Saucers.
It would have been one of the first books on flying saucers. Never mind just crashed flying saucers, right? I think there were maybe a couple of books.
Privately published books.
No, this was the bestseller. This book became a very big book back then.
Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness!
Very controversial at its time as well.
we have our own edition of the book out, and it continues to remain of interest to a lot of people. We get orders for Behind the Flying Saucers. The Truth About the Aztec UFO Crash. That's our updated version that can be found on Amazon. We get requests for it almost on a regular daily basis. People who missed out on the story, and it is an incredible incident. And of course, for decades, it's been shrouded in a great deal of controversy. And it's only been in the last couple of years that more and more documentation has come out that there may actually be a bit of truth, maybe a great deal of truth to this particular incident. But we're not going to stop there.
Tim, let me mention here, Frank's most recent book is The Aztec UFO Incident, which came out in 2015 with a preface by Stanton Friedman himself. All right, continue.
But we also have with us our longtime friend, our good friend, Bill Birnes.
Bill Birnes,
who of course is probably best known for his 4-year stint hosting the UFO Hunters on the History Channel. It was four seasons, was it not, Bill?
It was 3 seasons. I did UFO Files before that.
Yes.
And Ancient Aliens after that, but it was only 3 seasons.
And of course, you also had a best-selling book that was on the New York Times best-selling list. And there aren't very many people in the UFO field who can lay claim to that. You are, is it the co-author? It says, on the cover, it says, with Bill William Birnes Right. The day after Roswell.
Right.
Uh-huh. And it's all about Philip Corso.
Story.
It's his story. But you, I take it, wrote most of the book?
Yeah, because there were a lot of different manuscripts that he had. A lot of different
That's one of the questions we wanted to ask you about, because there does seem to be concern about how much of the book may actually, have been, I don't want to use the word doctored, but added to by you or compilated by you from other sources or maybe from different manuscripts that he wrote. But we'll get into that. But I do want to start out with Frank and have him give us a little bit of background on the Aztec incident, because we all know about Roswell. And, of course, we've had on Harry Drew on the program talking about the supposed crash in Kingman, Arizona. And I've written a book myself on Majestic 12, which has been updated to UFO crash cases in fact and legend. And so I'm kind of well-versed on the subject. It's a real potboiler. I think if you're going to tell a good UFO story, the object, I've always said I'm only interested in a UFO if it's seen below treetop level. And, of course, as close to the ground as possible. And in these cases, I guess we could actually say they were embedded in the ground. So, Frank, why don't you just take over here and give us a little bit of information about the incident at Aztec. When did it take place? When did you first hear about it? And what supposedly is said to have occurred?
Thank you, Timothy. You know, it's I feel in comfortable company here because we've all read Scully's book. We've all read Day After Roswell. And I know Bill has read the UFO or the Aztec UFO incident. Mm-hmm. And so let's go back to pre-dawn, March 25th, 1948. Two cops driving along a highway in northwestern New Mexico. And those are lonely highways even today. And they see a glowing disc over their car, and it's wobbling as it goes to the northwest. They follow, and they've seen things like this before. This is not the first time they've seen objects they couldn't explain, but they're going to follow this and see if they can find out where it's going. Go ahead up the road, and there's a rancher coming out of his house before 5:30 a.m. to feed his goats, and this craft goes over his ranch. And it's heading straight north now. And it runs right into the cliff of a mesa across from his ranch. He says spark showered, but it didn't stop. It lifted up and kept going. And now they lose sight of it. And this craft keeps going north. And some oil field workers in Aztec, New Mexico, get a call from their supervisor that there seems to be a brush fire out on Hart Canyon Road. And they're dispatched out there, two of them, Doug Nolan, Ken Farley. And they go out there and to see the drip tanks below Hart Canyon Mesa. And the oil tanks are not in any danger, but there's something smoldering up on the mesa, which you can walk up it. It's not that hard a walk. You get up on, and sure enough, there's some brush smoldering, but there's a giant 100-foot aluminum-colored disc sitting on the top of the mesa, sort of leaning over 5 to 10 degrees. And they're astounded, of course. And this is like a disc with a dome on the top and a dome on the bottom. No landing gear that they can see, but the thing's just leaning over. And so what do? These guys are 18, 19 years old. You know, they're very young, and they're working. They're oil field roughnecks. And so Doug Nolan, he gets up and walks around on it. One of these, you know what I'm talking about. Hey, look at this, guys, which we all do when we're that age. Mm-hmm. He looks around, and it's the light's beginning to grow in the east. And the dome, he goes up to the dome, and he sees circles. And he said that today he would explain them as mirrored sunglasses, but they're portholes, and one of them has a hole in it, about the size of a quarter. He gets up close and he looks and he can see inside it. And he says he sees two bodies slumped over what appears to be a console of some kind. Well, these guys are walking around looking at this thing. Nolan's able to describe it in great detail. And other people begin to show up, oil field workers, ranchers, and the cops. Remember the cops? The cops show up, and they're on the mesa as well. And they're all there and for a few hours. But remember the rancher who saw the disc going over his property. He was so struck by it that he went to a nearby store where there was a phone available 24 hours a day. Phones were as rare in New Mexico as flying saucers, I think, at that time, personal phones. And he called Albuquerque, Kirtland Air Force Base, to tell them that he'd seen something very peculiar. And they took his report and said, okay, go home. We'll be in touch, as they do. And so as the sun came up, Doug Nolan says he saw something else that was so strange he'd never seen it before, a helicopter. There were no helicopters available then. And he saw this helicopter hovering over the mesa, and he didn't know what was more peculiar to him, the disc or the helicopter. Well, this was just the prelude to the arrival of the military. When they showed up in force, they're not sure where they came from. Camp Hale, Colorado, was just across the New Mexico border in Colorado. And the military moved in, and they learned a lot about Roswell. They blew it at Roswell, but when they got to Aztec, they had their game on. And there was about 16 people on the mesa. And the reason we know this is because Scott Ramsey interviewed both Doug Nolan and Ken Farley separately, 50 years later after it happened. And they were in their later years, not very well. And they weren't worried about their security oath at that point. And they both told Ramsey the story. And you know what? Those stories were identical.
Down now they had been in the military.
Doug Nolan had been. I don't know about Ken Farley, but uh-huh. Doug Nolan had been in the Navy. He was a very young guy in the Navy in World War II. He was served on a battleship, and so these two people give the same story, including how many people on the mesa and how many cops were on the mesa, which was an astounding thing in itself, and so. If you go to court and you have two witnesses who don't know each other and tell the same story, the jury is going to be swayed in your favor. All right. The military separated everybody. They interviewed them. They debriefed them and said they could never speak of this, that it was a matter of national security. And shooed them off the mesa, but not before the craft was opened up. Now, let's explain that. It didn't look like it had no rivets, had no seams. And just that little hole in what was a porthole. Well, somebody got a long pole. We're not sure whether it was the military or the oil field workers. I think it was the latter. And they stuck this narrow pole through that little quarter-sized hole and began poking around in the cabin. And they hit two buttons on the other side of the cabin. Now, remember, we all saw the day the earth stood still. And apparently, that's exactly what happened. The saucer just opened up, and then Doug Nolan could see the bodies in the upper level slumped over a console. Well, when the military got there, they found bodies in the lower portion. 14 to 16 little guys dead were taken out of that saucer and laid on the ground by the saucer.
That's a lot of bodies.
That's a lot of people. Yeah. And I don't know if it was a cruise ship or a scientific expedition, but they were all dead, and they were all the same, 36 to 42 inches tall, dressed in one-piece coverall-type suits, tight-fitting suits, and with metal buttons. These are some of the details that Frank Scully revealed in his book. And they were all sent away to never tell this story as long as they lived. There was also a preacher on the mesa that nobody knew, but the preacher was there because he had a church in Mancos, Colorado, across the border from New Mexico. And he had seen a dust trails going down the dirt road. And he did missionary work around at the Aztec area, taught Indian kids in Window Rock, Arizona. And he went down, followed the dust trail to the mesa, thinking there was an accident or something. He got up there and he saw these bodies. He went back to his church or to his home in Mancos that night, and he called the deacon of the church, and the deacon's son. He said, "I have to tell somebody. You don't know what I've seen. I have to tell you this." And the son related the story to Scott Ramsey, of course, many years later when he was an older fellow. And he said, "I always remembered the preacher's story because I'd never seen a grown man cry. This man said, I saw something that shook my entire belief in the universe." And so that's pretty good bona fide for a witness.
Well, now, can you tell us just a little bit more about, describe a little bit more the occupants? I mean, facial features, how many fingers, the color of their skin, the contour, and so forth?
Mm-hmm. Yes, they were, again, 36 to 42 inches tall. Their heads were slightly larger than human heads, but they looked like little guys, like, prepubescent children. But they didn't seem to have any hair. They had very small ears. They had very little in the way of nostrils. Their mouths were very, very thin, like a slit. Their eyes were larger than human eyes and seemed to be almost oriental, I think, as one person described it. But they were all the same. There was no rank badges on their uniforms. And you know what? There was no description of the fingers on their hands or the webbing that we hear about some alien, like Len Stringfield talks about. So we don't have that information, but definitely they were not human.
Did anybody at that time do a drawing either of the occupants or the ship itself?
Not as far as we can find at the moment. And they were, I think pictures were taken, but we don't have those. That's another story. But there's no sketches. The only sketch we have, and we reproduced in the book, was a sketch made by oil man Silas Newton, who gave a lecture at the University of Denver. And that's something that Scully started out with in his book. And I'm so glad you have republished the Scully book, because it's turned out that Scully was right. He was laughed at. He was called a dupe. He was called a hoaxer. And yet all the facts that we have been able to discover in this case show that Scully got the straight goods from those research scientists and from Silas Newton.
Well, now, Frank, was the story published anywhere before Scully released it in Behind the Flying Saucers?
Not that we can find. There was supposedly a story in an Aztec newspaper called The Hustler, but nobody's been able to find it. It's just a legend, so you can't count on that. And there was no publicity. And this is like I say, the military got their act together to make sure that no information got out at that point. And so until Scully brought out his book in September 1950, the public was not aware.
Well, you know, I think one of the things about the creatures found on the craft there at Aztecs is that unlike today, you know, the stereotypical UFO alien, you know, it's got the great big head and the big black eyes. These beings were a lot more human looking.
Yes, all the sources say so.
So it makes you wonder, you know, what's changed.
Well, I think that if you compare that description with some of the sketches we've seen of the Roswell aliens, they're very similar. Mm-hmm. They could have been the same species, but we're at a point now where we assume that there are more than one species observing Earth. Paul Hellyer, the former defense minister in Canada, has come out and said so, and he's a heavyweight as far as I'm concerned.
And I was thinking, Frank, and you know, it's been a while since I've read Scully's book, but I was thinking that the beings on board were said to have actually had like a little bit of hair on their heads, but
fuzz.
Something that's like it. That. Okay, that's right. Which I mean, that's completely different from you know the so-called modern stereotypical aliens, which really is more of a starting in really like the 1970s to 1980s. You know, before that, you had creatures that a lot of them were essentially very human-looking, if not, you know, sometime, you know, diminutive in size, but almost indistinguishable from, you know, regular people.
Well, now, Frank, is there any speculation as to where the craft or the bodies might have been taken?
Yes, we're very certain that when the craft was, and it took them a couple of weeks to do this, the craft and the bodies were first taken to Los Alamos, which was one of the most secure locations in the country at that time. And that's where the scientists did their initial inspection of the craft and possibly the bodies. Eventually, and we've just found this out since December when the book came out, we've now got a source definitely puts the Aztec saucer at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in the 1950s. Hmm. And that's a story that we're still working on. But it's amazing that women blundered into this hangar where this disc was sitting. And when they're hustled out, they were later told it was a flying saucer and that it was from Aztec. And they said, oh, the Indians? He said, no, this is from Aztec, New Mexico. And so that connection is pretty strong, and we're hoping to exploit that to some degree. Oh, one other thing about the aliens, Tim, and that is that these guys looked like they were cooked or charred or burned in some way. They were all the same. So they weren't gray, and they weren't whitish. They weren't green. They were brown. Mm. And some people have said, well, perhaps the hole was made in the upper atmosphere and they suffer from decompression. Some said maybe it was the strength of the radar at that time. As you know, radar is just microwave and can be very damaging when you're in the path of it. Mm. And others say it might have been the hole shot in their saucer when it went over Los Alamos by a 50 caliber anti-aircraft machine gun. And that then again, the decompression caused them to burn or get very high temperature. But that's all speculation.
And well, now how deeply was the object embedded into the soil?
Not at all.
Not at all.
It was a controlled landing. In 1948, that would seem impossible, but now we have drones that can do it. As a matter of fact, you can buy a drone and have it control land somewhere. And so it was a controlled landing. Who directed it, I don't know if they were all dead, but it was completely undamaged.
Well, it is time for our first break of the evening, and we will be back in a few minutes discussing crashed flying saucers. What a great topic.
Now back to exploring the bizarre with two of the most electrifying researchers in the paranormal. Your hosts, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, that sounds like a crash flying saucer to me, Tim.
Well, it landed on my head, let me tell you. Hey, Tim, before we go any further, I want to throw out a question here to both our guests. Okay. Are there any artifacts from any of these UFO crashes that you know about, whether it's Roswell or Aztec or Timbuktu or anywhere? Do you know of anybody who's got any physical artifact that they're hiding in their closet somewhere?
Well, speaking for myself, and I'm sure Bill has his own thoughts and maybe some things he can say, the Aztec saucer was complete. It didn't crash. There was nothing that was lying around on the ground. They say that there were some things inside it, including a book-type thing made of parchment pages with hieroglyphics that had as far as we know, were never translated properly. But all this stuff went to Los Alamos and therefore was not picked up by souvenir hunters. Maybe Bill has some better news for us.
Well, I mean, there were pieces, supposedly pieces of the Roswell debris still exist. They exist at Wright-Patterson. What I've been told is that as the process went over decades, the trail had to be made cold. And one way to make the trail cold is to take custody of the actual debris, although there is debris in Florida, is to take custody out of the away from the military, away from the United States government, and put it out to NGOs, kind of non-government organizations, and they do the research. So what we believe is that incredible amounts of material, not just from the Roswell craft, but from other craft as well, have made their way into the hands of NGOs, and that the scientists who are read in, it's a very select group, who are read in, really are still scratching their heads over a lot of this stuff. For example, nobody has yet figured out, it's one of the big puzzles, nobody has yet figured out how these particular crafts, nobody has found a propulsion system that even vaguely resembles something that would utilize dark energy. They don't really know what dark energy is, but they know there's a lot of it out there, and they know that, and they believe, they don't know, they believe that intergalactic craft have the ability to utilize this dark energy in some way, shape, or form they can't figure out, because that's what enables them to traverse these incredible distances in really matters of hours and days. So there is a lot of this material out there. In fact, according to Jackie Gleason, who actually reported to have seen one at Homestead Air Force Base in Florida, that's where he saw it. And he told his then-wife, Barbara, and next wife, Marilyn Taylor, that it basically changed his entire life completely, utterly. And that's what he told the folks at Sony Pictures when he was making Nothing in Common with Tom Hanks.
Gentlemen, I just want to remind our audience real quick that if you have any questions for our guest tonight, you can call us, you can text us any way that you know how. We'd love to hear from you. You know, our call-in number is 702-425-9230, and of course our Skype is KCOR Radio. That's KCOR RADIO. We want to hear your questions. And Bill, I wanted to ask you now, you co-wrote The Day After Roswell with Colonel Corso, and I was just curious how you first got connected with Corso. I mean, you know, what started the whole process with that book with him?
It had nothing to do with flying saucers, that's for mm-hmm. sure. It was, I was representing, this goes back a long time, I was representing a retired FBI agent by the name of Bill Romer. Bill Romer had written a book about how he had brought down the Sam Giancana gang in Chicago, and it became a motion picture at HBO, and he had another manuscript he wanted me to represent, and so I was working with a motion picture company in Los Angeles, in West Hollywood, to try to set up meetings for this guy to see if anybody would be interested. So I wasn't really working for them. I was working with a number of companies. Well, we never sold that, but shortly afterwards, they had asked me if I had any other work that I was doing in the area of, you know, true crime stories, not fiction, but true. So I told them a couple. And I said, well, let's get together. We did. And we kept on having meetings. In fact, I actually sold another movie to another motion picture company that was in the same building. And they finally came back and said, just off the cuff, would you be interested in working with them after you sign all these non-disclosure agreements? Would you be interested in seeing the material of somebody who said that he was part of the Roswell cover-up? I said, well, you're talking about an eyewitness? He said, yeah, we're talking about an eyewitness, somebody in the military, a very high rank, a senior officer, and we believe that you might find this interesting. And that's how I got involved in the story.
Well, now, you had heard of the Roswell crash at that point, but, I mean, had you had any previous interest in, you know, the UFO phenomena or anything like
that
before?
Sure. I mean, sure. I mean, I grew up in the late 1940s, early 1950s. And so we all heard about the Roswell crash. I mean, that was a kind of a common knowledge. That was in the newspapers. And after 1952 and all the newsreel stories of the UFOs over the nation's capital in Washington, D.C., those 2 weekends in July, and all the UFO stories. I mean, back in the 1950s, every time there was a UFO sighting somewhere, somehow, that person turned up in the movies or on the radio or on television. So, yeah, we're fascinated. And so, but it was the kind of thing where you, and then I had my own sighting when I was a kid living in New York City. And so, but I mean, it was all tamped down. I was actually working in the publishing and motion picture industries at that point.
So
that just came out of left field.
So when you first started working with Corso, then, I mean, he had several different versions of that manuscript
there were different manuscripts. I mean, part of the problem with this company was that nobody they had worked with, nobody they'd spoken to, really could try to capture the essence of reverse engineering. And the problem was they tried to make a movie. And Corso had been out in Las Vegas and he'd been talking to people like George Knapp, and they wanted him, but they really couldn't sell it. There was no interest. And so then the thought arose, and this is before I got there, the thought arose, well, if we had a book and the book did relatively well, we could sell the book as the story because the book has a level of a gravitas to it. Even if the story's challenged, it's still out there. So that's why he began to collect his different manuscripts about different aspects of the same subject. I mean, he wrote one book, but the real story was, and that's why they couldn't put a finger on it. The real story was that Corso was doing what he said he was doing, getting these artifacts out to various defense contractors, he was doing this under the noses of the CIA, which was tracking his every movement. I mean, that was part of the story. He was talking about the Roswell material and what happened to it as part of a larger cover-up inside the government of wars, tough wars, but I mean actual wars among the various agencies, specifically the United States Army and the CIA. And he was in the Army. And so he was telling that story of what happened to the Roswell debris in the context of that larger story. And nobody could get a handle on that. They were looking at, oh, reverse engineering and lasers and things like that. And I said, oh, you mean you were trying to do all this, but keeping it away from the CIA that was trying to collect all the evidence? That's the story that I'm trying to tell.
Well, now, Bill, what year would this have been? And was Corso still in the military? When did he retire?
Well, Corso retired all the way back in the 1960s, 63 or 64. But so, no, he was not in the military. In fact, he only came to our attention. And again, he had come to our attention by accident, because while I was working with the company, they were also doing a book, and I was actually initially hired before this all this UFO stuff started. I was initially hired to edit a manuscript on POWs missing from the Vietnam War. That was the original purpose of my talking to this company, that they had different manuscripts from different people, and they wanted somehow to put these together and get published. So I was their publishing agent, their editor. And so that was how this whole thing started. The way Corso came to their attention, our attention, was that he was testifying before Robert Dornan's subcommittee on MIAs in the House of Representatives. And Corso was a prize witness. And he came to our attention through two sources. One was a retired CIA station chief, and another was the author who wrote the book Inside the PLO, Neil Livingston. And the fascinating thing was both told us the story of this guy who the story was pretty fascinating. He was the military liaison, among the military liaison, but he was a lieutenant colonel, so he was the military liaison to General Eisenhower's national security staff, not council, but staff. So he was a staffer, basically. And he was in charge of, and since he had negotiated Operation Little Switch, Big Switch, he was on that negotiating team for Douglas MacArthur. And then President Eisenhower, at the end of the war, he just moved over to the White House. And he was still in the Army at this point. He was read into all this stuff. So that was the story he was telling about his years at the Eisenhower White House and trying to piece all this together. And at the Eisenhower White House, Eisenhower signed off on a finding, a presidential finding, where he acknowledged the fact that we were leaving American service personnel behind in Korea. This was in 1953. That we're leaving American servicemen behind in 1953. So Corso mentioned this in the 1994 congressional testimony. And of course, people were saying, impossible, fiction, fantasy. This guy's making it up. He's a hoaxer. He's this. And they looked everywhere, the National Archives, to find that finding. They couldn't locate it. Finally, it dawned on somebody, look at the Eisenhower Library in Pennsylvania, which they did. They actually found the document, and in Eisenhower's handwriting, it said, pass to Corso. Well, suddenly, overnight, Corso becomes a different kind of figure. So we're talking to him about the POW MIA book, hiring him as a consultant, when he suddenly drops the bomb. He says, you don't care about Roswell or the Kennedy assassination? And we said, what do you mean? He said, well, I investigated the Warren Commission for the Senate Judiciary Committee in 1963. You don't want to hear about that? There was a cover-up. And we're like astounded. And so we said, well, why would you... an Army lieutenant colonel, retired lieutenant colonel, why would you be investigating the Warren Commission? So I said, oh, it was after I got that Roswell debris safely stowed away. I guess they trusted me. And that's when things began to unravel.
Your face must have dropped when you heard that, Bill.
Oh, yeah.
So that was some meeting. So that was how I got involved.
What about the Bill? What about the controversy about the introduction of the book from Senator Strom Thurmond?
Corso had known Strom Thurmond for years. Their relationship went all the way back to 1950. I want to say 1956. Corso's boss, the boss Corso would eventually, it was this guy called Arthur Trudeau. He was a lieutenant general. And Corso was, at this point, he'd served on the Eisenhower staff. He knew this would be before 1957. He knew that at some point Ike was going to let him go off to work on guided missiles somewhere. So what happened was, Arthur Trudeau was the commanding officer of Army Intelligence G2, and he stumbled across evidence, intelligence, that the former head of the Nazi Secret Service, of the one of the main players, Galen in the Nazi Secret Police, his agency, Henry Kissinger, at the very end of World War II, had helped patriate a lot of the ex-Nazis into the United States. I mean, that was because they were willing to give all this information, and it was valuable intelligence, and that was Henry Kissinger's role. So he actually patriated huge swaths of the Nazi infrastructure into the United States. Galen was left in place, but now in West Germany, and he was our top CIA spy. That spy ring, the Galen spy ring, was a top CIA spy ring. And what Trudeau had found out was that the East German Stasi, the very famous Stasi, the German spy ring, had penetrated Galen's spy ring. And so instead of playing by the rules, Trudeau went public saying the CIA's main spy ring in Eastern Europe had been penetrated by the Soviet, by the East Germans and the Soviet Union. Well, Alan Dulles was so furious at Trudeau that he wanted him fired from the army. He said that level of insubordination from a two-star general, he should be fired. Well, the military people on the national security staff were outraged because they thought that Trudeau was doing a very patriotic duty. So what they did was Corso led a group of them to Strom Thurmond, who was the head of the Armed Services Committee in the Senate. And they led a bunch of them to Strom Thurmond, and they complained. Now, remember, this is all happening at the height. Well, not at the height, but right in the wake of the Senator Joe McCarthy blacklist, the Senate blacklist. This is right around 1956-57. So this is in the wake of that blacklist. And so they go to Strom Thurmond, and Strom Thurmond basically tells Eisenhower, since the Senate has to vote on turning colonels into generals, they have to vote to grant a star, to bestow a star in a general rank. They tell Eisenhower that unless he figures out what he's going to do with Trudeau and doesn't force him out of the army, there'll be no more generals. That's it. The army is shut down. And so what Eisenhower does, what Corso says he and some other officers worked out, was Trudeau gets his third star. So he becomes lieutenant general, and he's pushed over to some backwater jerkwater command, which is Army R&D, foreign technology, and he can spend his next couple of years there and retire. And that way, Alan Dulles is pacified. Trudeau stays in the army. The army's officers are pacified. The Senate will bestow more stars on upcoming generals. And Eisenhower saves a lot of face by theoretically promoting Trudeau to a lieutenant general and giving him in charge of a whole new command. What they didn't know, of course, what Corso didn't know at the time, was one of the first things that Trudeau would find at Army R&D was the plan to colonize the moon. This is 1956 now, the plan to colonize a moon with fortified military installations. And that woke everybody up.
but how did the introduction get into the Roswell book?
Oh, well, after that meeting we all had, and Corso was saying, and they tried to farm it out to engineers, and engineers couldn't handle it. They tried to farm it to somebody else. And finally they said, look, what do you make of this stuff? And I said, it's interesting. I said, there's got to be some more paperwork here. And sure enough, Corso had a whole mountain of notes and paperwork and reports, and some of them from the Army Arthur Trudeau's own memoirs. He had died a couple of years before. So so we began talking about the various aspects of the book. And I was in California. I'd be on the phone with Corso at 3 and 4 in the morning, and we'd talk for a good chunk of the morning. Then he'd poop out by about 9 o'clock my time. And we would talk the next day, and that's how we did the book. And of course, he would come to California with boxes of manuscripts that I'd have to go through.
But I had heard that Senator Thurman disavowed his introduction once he found out it was about the Roswell incident.
Well,
he thought it was about another manuscript.
Well, that's exactly what happened. He didn't. His staff disavowed it. He didn't.
Oh, okay.
What happened was. Corso knew Thurman very well from that whole Eisenhower adventure. And Corso had written a book called, I think, I Walked with Giants. It was about his experiences in World War II, meeting Churchill, meeting Eisenhower, meeting all these famous people in World War II. And so that was the book. And so originally, Strom Thurmond had written the introduction to, the foreword, not an intro, but the foreword to that book. So when the time came, after we sold this, Simon & Schuster said, look, Phil, we're going to give you some rights and permissions forms, and they're already filled out. The permission is that Strom Thurmond will transfer the foreword that he wrote for the one book to The Day After Roswell, which was now the book's title. So Court said, fine, I'll go to D.C., because he was in Florida. He said, I'll go to D.C., and I'll ask him. Shouldn't be a problem. Goes into D.C. I'm on the phone. So he goes into D.C. Now, you have to try to picture this, that Strom Thurmond was not only mostly blind, but he was mostly deaf. Hmm. Corso was mostly deaf. He had hearing aids. They looked like the size of gold tickers, stock tickers in his ears.
Oh, Bill, we're going to have to interrupt you here. Unfortunately, it's time for our break, but we'll continue this right after this.
Exploring the bizarre, your e-ticket ride into the world of the paranormal. Strap yourself in as we traverse the universe, exploring the unexplained. UFOs, ghosts, lost worlds, cryptozoology, as well as other dimensions. It's time to take back the night. Now, your electrifying hosts of Exploring the Bizarre, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
All right, we're into our third segment with an hour to go, and a fascinating subject it is. It's a saucer in a tempest, if there ever was one. And tonight we have on Frank Thayer, who has actually co-authored a book along with Scott Ramsey, on the incident at Aztec, and our old friend Bill Birnes, who's got a new book out on UFO Hunters. It's volume 2, is it?
Yeah, it's the second volume in the series. It focuses on the second and third seasons. And it's got the story of Dulce in it. It's got a few other major stories in it, Roswell and Dulce and things like that.
Now, wouldn't you say that it's rather unusual for a book to come out about a TV show that's been off the air for, 4 seasons now?
Well, it would, except the fact that it's in reruns. And
yes.
It's in reruns, and Ancient Aliens is still producing.
Yes.
And I'm on the Discovery Channel actually this week for the NASA's Unexplained Files. So it would be, but... they just had postponed it from last year, and they originally wanted 2 books, but they wanted them spaced out so that the first book 1 had a chance to either sell through before the second one came out. They both wound up in mass market.
Any chance the show might be revived?
I've done a few pilots already. They've circulated. I've done a couple of pilots on themed reality series that are spin-offs from this. Mm-hmm. But so far we've had no activity. I mean, I promoted a couple myself, but we'll have to see if it gets picked up.
That would be good news. I think we're missing actually a good UFO series at the moment. I mean, straight, you know, the Ancient Astronauts have been going on, I think, now for about six seasons. But UFO-wise, the tube seems to be kind of empty at the moment. Was Hangar 1 picked up again?
I don't know. I'm not really friendly with those guys. And they had asked me to be on Hangar, not Venturi and Harzan, but the yes. producers had asked me to be on Hangar 1 a long time ago. But for some reason, that ball got dropped. And so I really don't know. I mean, first of all, the whole tenor of that segment of the industry has changed. That's one of the problems, that history was once history split into two separate channels, history H and H2. Mm-hmm. History began doing more scripted stuff, more expensive stuff, stuff that really lent itself to a quasi-dramatic series, while H2 was the repository for the shows like UFO Files and the reruns and Ancient Aliens.
Well, you know, History 2 is now going to be called Vice. They're bringing over the shows from History 2 to History and starting, I guess, a whole new concept. I don't know what Vice means offhand, but it would seem like it would be a crime shows of some sort.
Well, Vice is a show on HBO right now. Bill Maher owns that show, and it is a very edgy news show. So I'm wondering if that's the same show that's coming
because now according to this, and they've been running the ads for it the last couple of weeks, all the shows that are on History 2, I guess that they're going to keep, are moving over to History, the regular History Channel, and the whole network there is being called Vice, History Vice or something like that.
Hmm.
It's not just one show, yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting. The big issue was budgets back around 2010, 2009, 2010, that they really had to reallocate. They were going to be spending some more money. First of all, there was a big merger of the companies inside the capital cities owned. History is owned by A&E. A&E is owned by Cap Cities, ABC. That's owned by Disney. So they were reorganizing that particular that corporation, and a lot of the offices got merged, A&E with History and History with H2. And they spun off H2 as a separate network at the time. Now they may be changing it. That may have attracted some investment. But that's really what it was back then. And the mandate was they couldn't spend any money on they really had a hit with Ice Road Truckers. That was the show.
Yeah.
Shows like that, where shows like Ice Road Truckers, Storage Wars, things like that, where they really wanted that organic interplay between the stars. UFO Hunters didn't really provide that. And so it was more, so they figured, why spend that much money on UFO Hunters when they could spend a lot less and go back to the old UFO Files format, which really only cost them like $25,000 an episode, as opposed to $250,000 an episode.
Big difference. Now, did we finish up on the incident involving Corso and Strong Thurmond and the introduction?
No, we didn't. What happened was Corso had gone to Washington specifically to talk to Senator then at that point, John Glenn and Strom Thurmond. Because Glenn supposedly was fascinated by Project Horizon, the fortified moon base. And the other person was Strom Thurmond. So Strom Thurmond's Senate office was like as big as a ballroom. I mean, you've got to imagine this guy the dean of that Senate. It was a huge office. Neither of these two individuals could hear each other, and Strom and Thurman probably couldn't even see Corso. So Corso was asking him, he said, I need to ask you a favor. And so Strom and Thurman goes, yeah, now I'm on the phone during this time. And he says, yeah, yeah. And he says, I need to take what you wrote for Walk with Giants and give it to Day After Roswell. And so Strom Thurman was going, sure, Phil, sure, sure, I'll do that, sure, no problem. And he says, well, here, I need you to fill this out. So it was all filled out. All they needed was Strom Thurman's signature. So he takes his stamper. He doesn't sign anymore. He stamps it. And he stamps a few copies, and Corso comes back. I meet him in California. He gives me the copies. I give them to Simon & Schuster. That's how Strom Thurman.
God.
And then afterwards, it was his staff then that objected to it.
Well, what happened was Simon & Schuster does publicity for the book. The book is released at the Roswell anniversary in Roswell. And SNS puts a lot of money into the book. It was originally going to be a mass market, another UFO book, who cares? But they liked the book. So they made it into a hardcover. It was the first hardcover they were doing in a long time. And that it gets some traction. I get a lot of radio appearances, and so does Corso. And suddenly there's a lot of hubbub about the book. And one of the things that happened was that as soon as the publicity was released in that first edition, Strom Thurman's name is on the cover. Well, the reporters were, I mean, I am telling you, the line around Strom Thurman's office when the press got a hold of that book was longer than the smoked fish line at Zabar's. That's how long that line was.
He was probably so hyped up, he was ready to go for another term.
He was, his staff was livid. I mean, they were incandescent with rage.
Yes.
What do you mean you put that forward on a UFO book? And I got a phone call from the legal department at SNS. I thought my ears would fall off. I said, you have the release in your hand. What more do you need? I was on the phone.
Yeah.
What do you want? And they said, this turns, and we're going to take your, you're going to, you know, the usual threat. So as it turned out, they negotiated this deal with, it's a very nuanced, very Washington statement that what's his face released, or his staff released. He didn't release anything. They released, the staff said that Senator Thurman, remember that the foreword was that the material you're about to read in this book helped the United States win the Cold War. That's how we ended this thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, originally that was intended for Corso's meeting these great world leaders. Now it meant the Roswell debris. Well, the staff read that. And the staff is going, now remember, SNS had read this forward, so this was not a big shock to them. They had read this. Because Corso's attitude was, here's a forward, he wrote me, he said, use it anywhere you want. See, how it all started was Strom Thurman had written this forward for Phil Corso, and said, Phil, you could use this any way you want to. Here's my forward for your book.
Yeah.
Okay, it was one of those things. And Phil was originally using it for I Walk with Giants. So it was this generic kind of forward. So the deal that SNS worked out, first of all, the staff, Strom Thurman, gave this very strange response saying the United States did not need UFOs to win the Cold War. So he denied nothing in the book. It was simply, this is outrageous. We didn't need UFOs to win the Cold War, but how dare we? And that was their attitude. And that died away, but for the first 50 or so thousand books carry his forward. Yeah. In fact, that first edition with his forward See, they were going to take the forward out after the first printing. What they didn't know was while they were negotiating with Strom Thurmond's staff, the second printing was already underway.
Boy, that's a heck of a lot of books, Bill.
That's a heck of a lot of books.
How many copies eventually were printed or sold on that? Do you know?
Well over 150,000, approaching 200,000.
For a hardcover book today in today's market, or even in that market, you can hardly beat it. You'd have to be, like President Clinton or something like that.
Well, the person to beat, remember, I was writing true crime at the time. That was my main field. And I can tell you that the big names in that field were selling far more than 150, 200,000 books. It was Annie Rule selling 11 million copies in hard.
Okay.
Gentlemen, I'd like to bring Frank back into the conversation here, because I've got a question, Frank, about the Aztec incident. And it just seems to be, in my opinion, compared to a lot of the other crash saucer stories, that there's not a lot of love for the Aztec crash. It's almost like it's the redheaded stepchild of UFO crashes. I mean, why do you think that is? I mean, why out of all of them, that one seems to get the most grief?
I think we've got that pinned down, Tim. Let's go back to 1950 and the University of Denver. Here is where Silas Newton, the oil man, gets up in front of a bunch of science 101 people in the lecture theater at University of Denver at high noon, and he tells them there was such a thing as a flying saucer. We know exactly what he said because we found the original recording of his lecture in the archives of the University of Wyoming, and it was done on a wire recorder. Your producer would certainly have to say, you know, I've heard about those, never saw one, but before tape and before we have digital, we had wire recordings. Wonderful audio quality. I've listened to everything he had to say that day, and he was replacing Scientist X. He went on as Scientist X, but Scientist X wouldn't go on. And as Scully wrote in his book, those who would tell their secret for nothing in 1949 would not say anything for $20 million in 1950. So Silas Newton says, I'm going to do it. He knew the story. The scientists who worked on the saucer had talked to him, and he got up in front of this crowd at the University of Denver and told them about a flying saucer that landed at Aztec and was recovered by the military. They hustled him off the stage after about 55 minutes, and the Air Force showed up very quickly thereafter for some reason. And this is the beginning of the problem. He gave his lecture in March 1950, and he told Frank Scully about it. Frank Scully used that as a platform for his book, as you well know, the lecture at the University of Denver. But there was a spoiler, isn't there always?
Of course.
A spoiler named J.P. Kahn, C-A-H-N, worked for the San Francisco Chronicle, and he was born rich. He didn't have to work at all in his life, but he was a very good writer. I've read his stuff. He is excellent. And he went to Scully. He heard about this saucer story, and he wanted to buy it from Scully. He wanted to break it in the San Francisco Chronicle and be the big man on campus. Scully wouldn't sell. Scully brought out his book in September 1950, as we've talked about, sold 50,000 copies, which in 1950 was a bestseller. Mm-hmm. Well, J.P. Kahn decided he was going to get them. He was going to prove that it was a hoax. He was going to destroy the reputations of Scully, of Silas Newton, Newton's partner, Leo Gebauer from Phoenix. And for the next 2 years, he worked at it. Anybody remember True, the men's magazine?
Yeah.
Well, they ran Major Kehoe's probably the first national article on UFOs that Kehoe wrote.
January 50. But in September 52, J.P. Kahn wrote the article, The Flying Saucers and Mysterious Little Men. A very, very long article that had nothing to do with flying saucers especially, nothing to do with little men especially, but it had to do with the criminal activities of Silas Newton, the oil man, and how he was a con man and a crook. He was telling stories about flying saucers that couldn't be true. And by November of 1953, after working with the FBI, by the way, J.P. Kahn was able to get charges filed against Silas Newton and his partner in a Denver court, district court, for fraud of supposedly Newton had defrauded a fellow in a deal for oil detection or whatever. And but Silas Newton was an educated man. He was a geophysicist. He was a millionaire. I mean, $25 million in before 1950 was a heck of a lot of money. And they went to trial in November of 1953. And if you read the transcript of the trial, you realize that it was a put-up job. It was determined. The FBI was very, very helpful in building these charges. Kahn was in the courtroom in Denver, and they were found guilty, Newton and Gebauer. But you know what? They were never sentenced. Newton had to pay the court cost, $1,500, but didn't go to jail, was never fined. But the job was done. From that day forward, the Aztec story was considered a hoax, and no reliable researcher would even look at it, right up until the 1980s. So that's the backstory on that one.
Now, I seem to remember, wasn't Silas accused of trying to sell, what do they call it, like a doodle bug?
Doodle bug.
Supposedly, you know, detected oil and stuff like that.
Well, and of course, it's common knowledge today. These devices are used all the time. Mm-hmm. But what they did in the court, they didn't allow Newton to bring his device into court. They went down to an Army surplus store and bought a black box that said, well, this is similar. We're going to introduce this as evidence to show it doesn't work.
that was kind of a frame-up, wasn't it? Yeah.
He really must have had, you know, it's funny, you know, when you say that and you wonder in the transcripts, how bad was Silas, how was his representation in court? Because the standard thing in any court is that what the government introduces as a piece of evidence is rebuttable with your own introduction of evidence. And so just the fact that the government introduced what it introduced should have allowed Newton to introduce his own device.
If you look at the transcripts of this trial, the judge disallowed it. He said, yes, we're going to let them use this substitute device, and no, you may not bring the other device
in.
And that's
grounds for appeal.
Yes, but it never went to appeal because they never had a sentencing.
Right.
Very strange. But I think that the goal there, it wasn't to punish Newton in court, but rather to destroy the story, destroy his credibility, and make Scully look like a dupe. Because Kahn went to Scully and said, if you will just write an article saying that I was duped by Silas Newton, then we'll stop all this. But Scully wouldn't do it. Scully, to the end of his life, said, the story's real. I talked to the scientists. I talked to Silas Newton. And Silas Newton, you know what? We found in the University of Wyoming archives a typescript of Silas Newton's autobiography, at least part of it, of 200 or 300 pages. And throughout the whole thing, he talks about the Aztec incident as real, absolutely real. And we've put an article or one of his letters into our book, The Aztec UFO Incident, where he writes to Scully and says, we have done much good with this story. And so he was a believer. Scully was a believer, and only the American people lost faith.
Mm. Well, now how? Okay, so we have to go travel forward quite a number of years into the future when your co-author Scott Ramsey first heard of the incident. How did that come about?
Scott Ramsey sells wire, magnetic wire for winding generators, and one of his customers was in the Four Corners area. They have a San Juan generating plant there. And he went there, and he was having a beer one night. And somebody said, what are you going to do this weekend? I'm going out hunting. And I said, well, where are you going to go hunt, look for deer? I'm going out by the old crash site. And Scott Ramsey perked up, said, crash site? Airplane? No, no, supposedly some spaceship crashed out there. And Scott decided he wanted to go see for himself. And that started, that was in 1986, and that started 30 years of research for him. And it cost him $500,000 by the time he was done. And he's not done yet. So he began to look around, and he joined another fellow named William Steinman in spirit. William Steinman in 1982 went to Aztec after finding Scully's book in a Los Angeles bookstore. And
we'll have to go to break. Yeah, we'll continue that.
We got to hear more about this.
Yes.
We'll be back in a few minutes.
Now back to exploring the bizarre with two of the most electrifying researchers in the paranormal. Your hosts, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Wow, listen to that. Hey, I have a question I want to throw out before we get back to Frank, because we certainly have more to hear about Aztec. Both Bill and Frank, and you too, Tim, how many legitimate UFO crashes do you think there have actually been? Let's start with Frank. What would you say?
Quite a few. I think that I've read a number that I would consider worth considering, and I don't. But you have to be careful about which ones you say are real. And I know Bill, I have watched UFO Files and all his other programs. A lot of this stuff has been chronicled, and whether it's Coyami, Mexico, or Del Rio, Kingman, Arizona, chime in here, Bill.
Yeah, well, I think you're really talking close to 1,000, because you know you've got a really.
Oh my God, where's all the wreckage?
First of all, we're talking about the old Soviet Union. We're talking about crashes in Russia. You're talking about crashes in China along the Silk Road. You're talking about crashes in South America, and in Europe and in Africa. So I mean, what you're really talking about is that there have been a lot of UFO crashes. Now, maybe in the United States it's under 100. I think it's more than that, but let's say it's under 100. But when
my goodness, it's safer to go on a 747 than it is a flying saucer.
Well, yes, it is. I mean, but when you think about the causes of those crashes, I mean, you talk about UFOs in the Soviet Union, some of the incredible stories coming out of the Soviet Union, like UFOs are like fighting in the sky, and one of them crashes in a park and outside of Moscow. You know, you're talking about a UFO that they shot down. You're talking about UFOs they shot down in the North Sea. So when you compile all this stuff, it really turns out that there's a whole hell of a lot of UFO activity around the planet.
Yeah, and here's the thing. A fellow named Frank Fischino wrote about the Braxton County.
Right. Yeah, but, the Braxton County Monster, yeah.
He did some studies about U.S. combat aircraft crashing, and he found that in the early 50s, more combat aircraft crashed in the United States than were lost in combat in Korea. And there was a policy there, shoot them down. We were trying to shoot them down, and maybe we're successful sometimes.
Well, you read the Edward Ruppelt book, the 1956, about the UFOs in Washington, D.C., which is really what Frank Fischino was writing about and shoot them down. Mm-hmm. You're seeing that there were instances where there were actual dogfights between UFOs and the American jets. And so what Fischino was talking about is that it's not just one UFO that crashed in Braxton County, West Virginia, but it was one that crashed, it bounced, it crashed again. Another UFO came down to take help that and get it back in the air. I mean, so there are some incredible stories of
incredible.
Yeah, very incredible stories.
Now, Frank, when it comes to the Aztec crash, do they know almost exactly where it came down? Because I know, like at Roswell, it's still very controversial, just exactly, you know, the location of you know, like where the debris field was found, and you know, possibly the area of the alleged second part of the craft. But what about the Aztec crash?
That's one of the advantages here. The exact spot is known. X marks the spot. I've been on top of the mesa. You walk up, looks like an old road was cut up. It's not a very large mesa, but why would you have a road going up on top that didn't go anywhere? And you get up there, and sure enough, there's a flat spot, just a little bit bigger than 100 feet in diameter, and there's some scrub juniper trees at the border. But this is exactly where it landed, and they know exactly where it landed. And Scott and friends put a plaque in 2000, I guess it was, went up there and put a plaque on the mesa. Today, it's well known to people in Aztec. They have an alien bike run that goes from the town of Aztec 11 miles out to the crash site and then back. But it's a very scenic area. When you get up on there, you can see for miles. And this is where the thing landed. There's a little doubt about that. And all starting from William Steinman. Before the break, we were talking about that. William Steinman found an old copy of Scully and drove all the way from California to New Mexico to check it out. And he found, after talking to local people, was taken out to the crash site, where the old crash site, of course, and he found artifacts that were military artifacts, buried ration cans, M1 Garand clips that hold 8 rounds and stuff like that. And he wrote a book that nobody ever read, or very few people ever read, called UFO Crash at Aztec, A Well-Kept Secret. I didn't discover that book until 2006. And Scott Ramsey didn't know about the book when he started looking around in 1986. But Steinman's book is very good. It has a lot of the basic detail. And Steinman compared, and we've done this in the Aztec book, compared Scully and Steinman, description of the site, precise. Scully had never been to Aztec, but he knew exactly where it happened and what kind of, how far it was from the town. All those details matched exactly. We like it when they work out that way.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, Frank, how did you get involved in all this?
Well, ever since college, my first job as a reporter here in New Mexico, that I wrote some flying saucer stories, and I interviewed Riley Crabb at the Borderland Research Society.
I haven't heard that name in a long time.
Hey, we got to keep all that in perspective. And I talked to a lot of local people who had seen flying saucers in the 50s. And this is only in the middle 60s when I was doing this. And I was always sure that there was some reality to it. But later on, I guess what hit me was after I came back from Canada in 1977, all of a sudden in 1980, there was the Roswell incident, the Berlitz book. And I said, yes, I knew it. I just knew it. And I had to accept that. Thank you, Stanton Friedman, for locating Jesse Marcel. And that went on from there. So until I had my website, I guess it was in around 2006, 2007, I put together my website, frankthayer.net, and I had found Steinman's book, and I wrote an essay in my my website saying that people should look at Aztec. It appears to have some validity. And Scott Ramsey, for some reason, found my website, and he contacted me, and he said, hey, Frank, Scott Ramsey here. That's how he calls me every time he phones. And he said, I'm working on the Aztec thing. And I didn't know him from Adam at that point. And he told me what he was doing. I bought his DVD, Aztec 1948. And he said, it was in 2009. He said, we want to do a book. What do you think? And I said, I'm in. And so from then, I've been working on it for 6 years now. he's been working on it for 30, and we spent a lot of time writing, but it's been a pleasure, every bit of it.
Well, what about subsequent sightings in that area? I know, Tim, the Kingman, Arizona, alleged crash site. Supposedly, there had been a lot of UFO activity before the crash, and definitely a lot afterwards. What about this case? What about the Aztec case? I mean, you know, any additional UFO waves in that area?
Oh yes. Let's throw in chapter 4 of our book, and it's the Farmington Armada. In 1950, March 1950, there was a mass flyover of flying saucers over Farmington, New Mexico, which is
great case.
Yeah, 10 miles from Aztec. And people in the middle of the day, this was not a nighttime sighting. Mm-hmm. They said dozens to hundreds of silver UFOs darting around the skies. One of them was glowing red. And somebody said, I wonder if this, they're paying tribute to their lost comrades of 1948. And these saucers went, and they were seen in Las Vegas, New Mexico, which is southeast of that area. And it was, but this was scotched, and here's how this was spoiled. It was front page in the Farmington Daily Times, and we've covered it very well in the book. But the fellow who was the debunker was a fellow named Andy Andrews, state policeman. And he said to the press, this was fluff from cottonwood trees that people were seeing. And if you buy that, wait for the punchline. Here it comes. Andy Andrews was the cop who was on the Mesa in 1948. He knew better.
Ooh.
Got him.
Were there any photographs or anything of this UFO armada when it happened?
Apparently not. We're not aware of any photographs. But again,
That's too bad.
As a photographer, I can tell you that if a disc is in the sky 5,000 feet up or even 4,000 feet up, it's going to be the size of a pinhead with a 50-millimeter lens or even a 135-millimeter lens. You're not going to see anything of any import there.
But your eyes can pin that out. Yeah.
There were supposed to be, I think, 100 UFOs in the sky.
Yes. It just, they couldn't count them all. And it was the advertising guy at the newspaper went out and saw them, and he wrote the story. And we pretty well used his story verbatim in chapter 4 in the book. Mm-hmm. It should have been national news. It never was, because it was only cotton fluff, right?
swamp gas.
Memories of Donald Menzel.
Well, somebody needs to do a show where some of these historical cases are brought out, because there are so many grand cases. I mean, Leveland, Texas. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's just so many really, really good cases that prove the existence of UFOs, and they have been pretty much forgotten by today's crop of ufologists.
Instant debunking. The Lubbock lights. Oh, those were birds reflecting light from the streetlights below. And it looks ridiculous today, but I think people wanted to have them debunked. 33% of people in 1950 said, well, we don't believe in flying saucers. Today, at least 55% of people accept that some UFOs are extraterrestrial spacecraft. Yeah. And the more education you have, the more likely you are to accept it.
So do you think if Hillary is nominated or elected, that she's going to talk about UFOs? Because apparently John Podesta is running her campaign at the moment, and she was on some talk show, I guess, in New England, and he actually sent a text to the woman who was doing the interview and said, why didn't you ask Hillary about the aliens?
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. Bill Clinton was going to get to the bottom of it, and Jimmy Carter was going to tell the truth.
Yeah.
it's buried too deep, and many presidents are never briefed. I think Eisenhower knew. I think
Eisenhower knew. Kennedy knew.
Yes.
I don't know that Johnson knew, but I knew Kennedy knew. Nixon certainly knew, because Nixon was the one who told Jackie Gleason about it. Mm-hmm. Reagan probably knew what he shouldn't have known, because he saw a UFO on two occasions. And Jimmy Carter, of course, filed an actual formal UFO report for the UFO that he saw in Georgia.
Right.
Jerry Ford tried to investigate it. In fact, Jerry Ford took it to the Science and Technology Committee in the House, and they actually held hearings on it. But he was just blisteringly criticized by the head of Project Blue Book. And then when he became president, he said he was going to do something about it. And then there were actually two assassination attempts, both by the Manson family members, Squeaky Fromm and Elizabeth Moore. And this was in California. And Manson, when I was doing a book about serial murderers, and Manson told us flat out that he was working for the CIA.
And we didn't believe it at the beginning, but he could have been telling the truth. And of course, George Herbert Walker Bush, former head of the CIA, never breathed a word about UFOs, but he must have known.
Well, when Jimmy Carter asked him, when he was getting his CIA briefing, he asked Bush, what does the CIA know about UFOs? And George Bush said, you have no need to know. That was George Bush's response to Carter. You have no need to know. But then he said, anything you need to find out is already in the National Archives. He said, you have to know where to look. But he said, it's all in there.
And that's the story of Majestic 12, or whatever they're going to call it. And there is a shadow government that controls this information.
Well, remember that if you're saying no president has made disclosure, Harry Truman in 1950 said flat out, and I'm sure it was in partly response to Farmington, in response to Aztec. Harry Truman said flat out, these are flying saucers, and we know what they are. And this is on television. Mm. So that moment of disclosure by a United States president, that's already been done.
But it doesn't resonate. It doesn't penetrate.
It doesn't at all. It doesn't at all. And of course, the thing with Reagan was, Reagan was so enthusiastic about his sightings, he, when he was governor, I mean, he clearly hadn't been read in. When he saw the UFO over the Mojave Desert, he had his plane, his governor's plane, that was flying him from L.A. to Sacramento. He had to chase the UFO over the Mojave Desert, actually diverted his flight over the desert.
And you've covered that very well.
Yeah, the UFO just kind of flew away. And then when he was driving down from Pacific Coast Highway, again, he's the governor, he's driving down Pacific Coast Highway, and he was on his way to a part, Route 1 or Route 2 in California, right on the coast. And he was going to a party at the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel for William Holden. And he and Nancy saw a UFO right over the highway, went out into Santa Monica Bay. And he told everybody the person who told the story was Lucille Ball. Told the story of Reagan being so excited.
Yeah.
Well, long before that made the press, I did an interview with Steve Allen, and he told me he was there the night that Reagan and Nancy came in and they had been followed by the UFO. Yeah. I still have it in my notes here.
Excellent.
Right. Yeah.
They were late to the party.
Yeah, Reagan was fascinated by it. They were watching this thing over the highway. It was an incredible story. And so what you see are presidents from all the way from Truman really right up to Bill Clinton. And I mean, Dick Cheney really said, if I'd been briefed on UFOs, it would have been classified, so I can't talk about it.
That's right.
George Bush, basically George W., when he was asked, he jerked his finger over Cheney and said, he knows, ask him.
Well, it seems like only Republicans know. I mean, will Donald Trump be told the truth about UFOs?
God help us. The the thing about Hillary was so funny was that she made the contact, she made the comment to this reporter up in Concord, New Hampshire. And the whole history of the Clintons and UFOs are fascinating. A couple of things. One, Hillary, all the way back in Bill, after she made this whole vast right-wing conspiracy argument on TV about that people lined up against Bill Clinton, she had a seance in the White House with Jean Houston in which they tried to invoke the spirit of Eleanor Roosevelt. They were trying to channel her to give Hillary advice on how to deal with the right-wing conspiracy. So she's wide open to this stuff. The thing with Podesta, Podesta was part of the lawsuit with Leslie Kean, suing Leslie Kane, suing NASA over their withholding of the files from the Keksberg crash. And they won that lawsuit, and they didn't get anything from the Keksberg crash because NASA, they didn't have anything, they didn't know anything, but we know they were there. This was the 1965 crash in Pennsylvania. But the point was that Podesta was really angry. He wasn't that exorcised about UFOs themselves. It was the government secrecy that was really bothering him. And so that's why he got involved. And he's been urging the Clintons to come clean about UFOs for years. Remember, this is a 20-year thing with Bill Clinton.
Well, of course he wasn't, you know. The president's look at Clinton. I mean, he was on Jimmy Kimmel, and he sat there for 5 minutes talking about the subject, and you know that had to be pre-planned. You just don't have the the president of the United States on, whether he's the ex-president or the current one, and just pull questions like that out of your hat.
No,
they really pre-clear the questions with these hosts. I mean, Bill Clinton doesn't want to be embarrassed. He doesn't want to go on TV and get a Monica Lewinsky question. It's crazy. So you better believe it. It's not Bill himself that's going to prepare. It's going to be his staff that's going to say, look, these are the awful of the questions. This is what you can ask. And the host may say, I want to ask about UFOs. He'll say, okay, fine. Ask about UFOs.
But that seems to be a regular question to ask him, I think, at this point.
Well, now it is what he said in his book. Because what Hubble said.
You know, though, it is such a hot potato, though. I mean, look at the last election when the subject was brought up. It's like everybody ran for cover.
Right, exactly. I mean, really, what? And the funny thing in the last election was that Mitt Romney actually believes in UFOs because that's part of the religion, that UFOs,
yes,
they brought,
for sure.
That's part of the religion, the planet cover.
Right.
And Donnie and Marie did a whole thing about that. So, I mean, but they avoided that like the plague. The last thing the Republicans wanted was to have some talking about the planet Comar.
Oh, boy. Hey, listen, you guys, we're getting down to the nitty gritty here. And I want to give each of you the opportunity to give us your website information and Bill, the name of your new book and where it can be obtained. And Frank, you go first. Give us a shot.
Okay. Amazon's got the book. Barnes & Noble's got the book. Our website is theaztecincident.com, theaztecincident.com, all one word there. My website is www.frankthayer.net. And certainly, I hope the people will read the Aztec book, and I think that they will find that Roswell has a companion.
Must reading. Got to be in everybody's book collection. And Bill?
Well, yeah. The most recent book came out this week is UFO Hunters Book 2. It's available in all the bookstores. Amazon, of course, Barnes & Noble. You could get it from the Torforge Macmillan site. You could get it from, write to me at futuretheater.com. That's my website, www.futuretheater.com. Write to me.
And don't forget, your show is on Monday nights, right?
Right, Monday from 10 to 12.
All right. Good night, everybody. Thanks
Good
for
night.
A wonderful show.
Good night.
And we'll see you next week.
Good night.
You've been listening to Exploring the Bizarre with hosts Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz. They're taking back the night by jetting non-stop across the cosmos in search of the truly bizarre and totally unexplained, with you as their co-pilot. Thursday nights at 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, on the KCOR Digital Radio Network. For more information on exploring the bizarre and hosts Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz, check out their KCOR Digital Radio Network page. Follow their YouTube channel at MRUFO1100. Exploring the bizarre.